our sins, so as to prepare ourselves worthily to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to my brothers and sisters that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary the Virgin, all the angels and the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me, the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
If one would, that is mercy, and for this, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit. If only the Spirit of God dwells in you, whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he remained for 2 days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just trying to stone you, and you want to go back there?" And Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day? If one walks during the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks at night, he stumbles because the light is not in him." He said this and then told them, "Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but I am going to awaken him." So the disciples said to him, "Master, if he is asleep, he will be saved." But Jesus was talking about his death, while they thought he meant ordinary sleep. So then Jesus said to them clearly, "Lazarus has died. And I am glad for you that I was not there, that you may believe. Let us go to him." So Thomas, called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go to die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." And Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary secretly, saying, "The teacher is here and asking for you." As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. But Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So the Jews who were with her in the house comforting her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled, and said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Sir, come and see." And Jesus went. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died?" So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, "Take away that stone." Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, "Lord, by now there will be a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So take away the stone." And Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me, but because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in cloth. So Jesus said to them, "Untie him and let him go." Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done before began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We just heard the crowning miracle of all the miracles that our Lord did before his passion. It's the climax of St. John's story about Jesus of Nazareth. This miracle of restoring life led directly now to our Lord's own death. The irony of that moment. And certainly this gospel is fitting for all of us to hear and to pray about in light of what we as a world are going through now. Our brothers, our sisters are ill as well. And they too have died. And we too are waiting for them. When does hope die? When do we come to a situation where we can no longer imagine any good, or that we can see any success, but only failure and despair? For us Christians, the answer, of course, is never. Never do we believe that hope and goodness will die. Never will hope, faith, or love, those theological virtues that were given to us on the day of our baptism, will ever fade away, will ever be conquered by evil. Never do we as Christians believe that we will come to the point that we can no longer look forward with confidence in the power of God. Never will hope die, simply because of what we shall remember starting next week, the week that changed the world, the week that changed us. Never shall we lose hope, because we believe in the power of God. That power of God that is so active in the world today, through the love, through the concern of his children. For God has love and concern for his creation. For after he created, he saw that it was all good. For God is still in charge of his world, and he won't let this world fall apart. God is in charge of our lives, and he will never abandon us to evil and despair God who is opposed to evil that surrounds us. God has promised us through the darkness of days an ultimate victory. For those who believe in Christ, there never will come a point in our life when hope dies, because we believe the power of God is stronger than any other power the world can give. Of course, this doesn't mean that we're preserved from evil, but we need to wait for the Lord's final coming, that final victory, when he comes and restores all things once again. For evil can touch us and those whom we love, as we know, sadly, are finding out in a very personal way. But even as we face loss and sickness and death, we hold on to the hope that God's power is still active. God's power will still preserve us from warfare. In today's gospel, believe in the power of God. She believed in the power of Christ. She believed that Christ would do something. He would come and save her brother. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. I've always wondered, what was the tone of voice she uttered those words in? Perhaps anger, perhaps in despair, but I think in love. For Martha, her hope was gone then. There was no way that she could imagine that her brother would live again. And our Lord confronts her faults and says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. To show that power, Christ calls forth Lazarus from the tomb. And so we too, if we believe in God's power, can hold on to our hearts, open to God's power in our lives. It's not easy to hope in a world where so much is wrong. But Christians hold on to the hope because we believe in the power of God. We believe in the power that raised Lazarus from the tomb. We believe in the power that brought Christ back from the dead himself. So even in our darkest moments, goodness and life are available. Love continues even as we grieve, even as we suffer, even when our brothers and sisters are ill. We find life when we give ourselves to others in loving service. Even when we are discouraged and sick, we can still offer something of ourselves to others in their need. We find the power of the resurrection, the good deeds of others, in the prayers of the church, in the beauty of the Mass. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord. We have come to believe you are the Christ, the Son of the living God.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the worlds to come. Amen. And so we approach the throne of grace and favor and ask our God to hear our prayers.
For the renewal of our Catholic faith, a greater love and appreciation for the sacraments of the Church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our country and the countries of the world, may we live in peace and tranquility. Turning to God in our need, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and the suffering, particularly those suffering from the coronavirus, may their sufferings be eased by the knowledge of our prayers, love, and support. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the families of the dying, may they be consoled by our prayers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The doctors, nurses, and all of our healthcare workers, may they see the face of Christ in their patients as we thank you, God, for their dedication and many sacrifices. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead and all who have died, especially those who have died without family or friends around them, for their grieving families, may the light of Christ's conquering over death be their support and strength. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We present to God our particular intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. O good and gracious Father, we turn to you at this moment in time to plead to you to end this pandemic, to spare our loved ones and us from all sickness. Help those who are afflicted, their families who must see them from afar, and those who help and care for them. May our Blessed Mother, the health of the sick, and Saint Joseph, the protector of your Church, intercede for us now and at the hour of our own death. Amen.
Oh,
these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. And please to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Timothy, our Bishop, and all those who hold you to the truth, hand on the Catholic and the Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. All who are gathered, whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, while they offer for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially glorious Ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James and John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysostomus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service and that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this all of you and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Love me, history of faith. Command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, sight of your divine majesty. That all of us, who through the participation of this altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and now rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies. Graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, to their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. For those who cannot now receive Holy Communion, we pray. Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I am unable at this moment to receive you sacramentally, come as spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Next Sunday, Palm Sunday, we begin Holy Week, of course, and I will bless the palms privately at 7 o'clock, and blessed palms will be available from 9 until 5 o'clock in the front of the church for those of you who wish to come and receive blessed palm for the year. As the coronavirus 70 is spreading here in Rockland County, it's hitting home now where 3 of our parishioners have died so far, and a number of them are in hospitals and very, very ill, so please pray for all of them, and pray, of course, for their families. In some ways, the pain is even deeper with this virus because their families can't be with their loved ones, supporting them, comforting them in the hospitals or even at the funeral homes. So the families of the deceased, they suffer as well. So we have much to pray for, and we have people to pray for as well. Huh? And 4 days ago, we celebrated the solemnity of the Annunciation, that moment when God became one of us. And that moment that God is with us. And for us to always remember that, that we're never alone in this world. We're never alone in our sufferings and in our sadness. And knowing God and his experience of human nature and humankind for the first in a very real way. So he's with us and he's close to us, and we pray to him, asking him to give us the strength. So even the families, pray the rosary together. As difficult as this time is, it might be a blessing from God. He has given us
extra time in our life, quiet time. Time not to waste to watch TV or play video games, but rather to pray. Pray the rosary together as a family. Take the children out for a walk. Bring them to church. Our churches are open every morning from 7 until 7. Come, pay a visit to our Lord in the tabernacle, what's a Sabbath, and light a candle, and pray for our parishioners, our brothers and sisters who are suffering. And so, as always, if I or Father Clark can do anything for you or your family, please don't hesitate to call. Call the Parish Center, and they'll certainly get a hold of me. There's an emergency phone number there as well. There's also a great number of parishioners who volunteer to help shop and all the other different things that people may need. So if you need help, please don't be proud enough not to call. We're here. This is what family is all about. When things are going well, faith is cheap. But when things are difficult, this is when we gather together as a family to love and support and to help one another. And the sign of a good family is always there to help one another. Please know of our prayers, Father Clark and myself. Every day we offer private masses, and we offer them for you as well. So until we all see each other again, maybe in the neighborhood, walking around, we're certainly look forward to the beautiful day when all of us once again will gather in this beautiful Church of God. We pray for one another, and we pray that God will bring us to that light and that joy of knowing that somehow, some way, through all these difficult moments, great grace will take place, a renewal of our faith, a renewal of love for our sacraments, a renewal of our love for our families and our friends. And until that day, may God bless you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. Bless, O Lord, your people, who long for the gift of your mercy, and grant that what at your promptings that they desire, they may receive by your generous gift through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the blessings of Almighty God descend upon you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended. Thanks be to God. Prayer to St. Michael. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. We also now will pray a prayer to the Virgin Mary for protection. O Mary, you shine continuously on our journey as a sign of salvation and hope. We entrust ourselves to you, Our Lady, Health of the Sick. At the foot of the cross, you participated in Jesus' pain with steadfast faith. You, Our Lady of New York, know what we need. We are certain that you will provide, so that as you did at Cana of Galilee, joy and feasting might return after this moment of trial. Help us, O Mother of Divine Love, to conform ourselves to the Father's will, and to do what our Lord asks us. He who took our sufferings upon himself, and bore our sorrows to bring us to the cross, to the joy of the resurrection. We seek refuge under your protection, O Holy Mother of God. Do not despise our petitions, we who are put to the test. Deliver us from every danger, O glorious and ever-blessed Virgin Mary. Amen.